this is the world's deadliest reef. We've got lionfishes, moray eels, and even the deadliest fish in the ocean, the stonefish. And this camera is really special because, wait for it, it can record night vision.
The truth is, every time I drop cameras at night with bright white lights, I feel like I'm only seeing half the story. Predators stay in the shadows, hiding from the beam. But what happens if I take the light away, replacing it with invisible infrared light? Is true underwater night vision even possible? And will the elusive predators I've never filmed before finally come close? In this video, I'll be dropping cameras on the reef, on my favourite boat wreck.
Oh, look at that guy.
And in the deep, drawing creatures in with a seafood banquet.
We've got some squid and some mackerel. Gotta be a bit careful though, because there's eels absolutely everywhere.
Literally everywhere. These are white-eyed moray eels. Now, morays are normally solitary, tucked away in small cracks and crevices on the reef, using their lateral lines to detect prey. However, bait or carrion can override their territorial instincts. This isn't socializing or teamwork, but competitive feeding. Like all morays, these white-eyed morays are armed with pharyngeal jaws, shooting forward a second set of jaws in their throat to grab prey and drag it backwards. This, combined with their pointed faces, make them effective at pulling chunks of bait out of small crevices. Smaller eels also try to get in on the action, albeit pretty unsuccessfully. However, the white-eyed morays aren't the only eels that patrol this reef at night. I believe this is a yellow-edged moray, so named because of the yellow edging on the end of its tail. Now, these eels are seldom seen in groups and have little tolerance for the smaller white-eyed morays, especially when food is near. However, these eels are completely dwarfed by the predators that live on the wreck. After some time, the morays began to lose interest, creating the perfect opportunity for many other nocturnal creatures to get in on the action. This decorator crab, covered in sponges, algae, and other detritus, decided to make a run for it, albeit at the worst possible moment, as several morays decided to return to the cage to feed. On drop two, a large nocturnal brittle star that pushed its five long arms and small round body on top of the cage also received a similar welcome, although it seemed its downfall was somewhat self-inflicted. Unlike the brittle star, after arriving at the cage and being greeted by stimulated moray eels, this large bristle worm decided it probably wasn't worth the risk. However, the reason for building this infrared night vision camera rig was to prevent the light from scaring off photophobic fish, those that are scared of lights. Whilst morays are fish, they have incredibly poor eyesight and aren't typically bothered by anything. How would fish with big eyeballs and better reef sense react to the infrared light? And more importantly, would the elusive sharks and rays, the creatures we're targeting in the deep ocean, come close? The first fish with better than awful eyesight that showed up was the starry puffer. Puffers are very visual hunters, albeit with an appetite for crustaceans over fish and squid. This individual hung around the bait cage for some time, and whilst it seemed somewhat cautious, its willingness to return to the cage and venture closer was a good sign that the infrared light wasn't causing much stress. But puffers are slow, clumsy, and with a body full of toxins, they don't have much to fear on the reef at night. How would prey fish react? Would they feel exposed when illuminated by the infrared light? Luckily, drop 2 recorded some reassuring footage. Damselfishes, small groupers, and butterfly fishes spent a good amount of time loitering around the camera, seemingly unaware of or unbothered by its presence. Now, this result was probably expected given infrared light is invisible to fish. However, the underwater physics of infrared penetration is complex and required a little bit of testing.
Oh, and for you nerds that are super interested in the science behind infrared, we did test some different wavelengths of LEDs out, so here's how that went down. We've got two different wavelengths of infrared to try. Okay, so this one is the longer wavelength. This is about 940 nanometers, I think. You can see a little bit of a red glow look, but in general, it's almost invisible. But, oh, geez. This one is the shorter wavelength. This is about 750 nanometers, so there's a little bit of visible red light still in there.
However, there's a problem with some pretty big trade-offs.
Let's turn this on and see what it looks like.
The longer wavelength infrared is literally invisible, but gets absorbed and scattered incredibly quickly underwater, leading to a much darker image. The shorter wavelength has much better attenuation or penetration, but also results in some visible red light bleed. I think the sweet spot is somewhere in the middle, but those LEDs haven't arrived yet, so I'll have to make do with the 750s. I'll be testing the new ones out in the next video, and dropping the camera to 200 meters, so subscribe if you want to see the results. Back on the world's deadliest reef, it was promising that prey fish seem unfazed, but what about the predators? Small humpback, blue-striped, and two-spot red snappers featured frequently on the first two drops, and seemed unbothered by the lights. A wandering big-eye barracuda also flashed past the camera on a number of occasions. It's worth noting that I've never recorded barracudas at night. This reef is also covered in lionfish, although lionfish actually love visible light, using it to ambush prey. So, for obvious reasons, none came particularly close. But this is the world's deadliest reef, and so it seemed only right I test the lights on the world's most venomous fish. This is an enormous reef stonefish. Given their ambush purists, lying in wait hoping for unsuspecting prey to swim over the top, the stonefish is the perfect candidate to test the impact of infrared versus visible light. After illuminating it with the infrared light for a good amount of time, apart from the odd twitch, the stonefish remained static. This was the same for other individuals. After turning on the white lights, at first the stonefish remained stationary. However, it soon wiggled back further into the reef, seemingly bothered by the light. Was this a good indication of the benefits of underwater night vision? Perhaps, but I needed to test this further, and I knew just the spot, home to a pair of predatory fish that dwarf everything up in the shallows.
So, the eels definitely dominated the world's deadliest reef up here in the shallow water. But I've got a plan, because all the way down this slope is one of my favourite boat wrecks, and it's covered in some massive predators. I know it's down there somewhere, but it's just sand and it's pitch black. Oh, we found the wreck. Right, camera is rolling. Where are we going to stick it? Seems like a good spot. Fingers crossed, we're off. I'm just going to leave a scent of fish as I swim back up the slope. Hopefully it'll bring some more stuff in.
Immediately after leaving the camera, soldier fishes, cardinal fishes, fusiliers, and snappers came closer, checking out the bait and investigating the camera. An enormous large-nosed boxfish also drifted past just out of range, so named because of its large nose, of course. Unfortunately, the infrared light only penetrates about 2 meters, so we need creatures to come a little bit closer. Underneath the wreck, a small lobster appeared. However, the lobster seemed nervous, and for good reason, for this wreck is home to true ocean giants. This is an absolutely enormous honeycomb moray eel. At around 2 meters long, and with a body thicker than your leg, this individual is about as big as they get. For reference, the bait cage stands 10 centimeters tall. It's possible that this eel is 20 to 30 years old, and has perhaps spent most of its adult life on this wreck, hoovering up small fish and crustaceans that use it for shelter. You can see evidence of battle scars on its dorsal fin, perhaps old bite wounds from other larger moray eels. Now, these eels are typically crepuscular hunters, venturing out as the sun goes down to feed, and the fresh mackerel and squid in the cage is exactly what they spend their nights looking for. But in the ocean, it doesn't take long for news of an easy meal to spread. Now, unlike other species of fish, moray eels are not known to be monogamous, or form long-term partnerships of any kind with other eels. In fact, most morays are completely intolerant of others, unless the provision of ample food and space allows for a truce. But I first documented this pair over a year ago, and whilst every time I dive this wreck things change, one constant is that this pair of honeycomb moray eels are always tucked inside its interconnected chambers and cavities. Could this be a paired couple, or just two morays tolerating one another long term? After you've watched the footage, let me know what you think in the comments. So, moray eels actually have a really interesting anatomy, beyond their infamous double jaws, and display some very misunderstood behaviours. Firstly, they don't have traditional gill flaps like most fishes, but opercular siphons that stick out from the sides of their head. Most predatory fish that have these evolved them in order to make them more effective predators. In the moray's case, large gill flaps might catch as they dive headfirst into small crevices. They're likely also an evolutionary trade-off. After all, you can't squeeze large pumping muscles into a narrow head, so a small siphon is an elegant workaround. And these eels spend plenty of time using their large elongated snouts to dig around in search of food. But without large pumping muscles in their mouths, how do morays breathe? Well, despite many believing the moray's gaping mouth is a defense or threat display, what they're actually doing is drawing in water to ventilate their gills. Morays are adaptive hunters. Whilst they actively scavenge, they also pick off live food, albeit they're not the most athletic predators in open water, which, combined with their poor eyesight, means their chances of a successful strike are pretty slim. Whilst they half-heartedly lunge at the schools of cardinal fish and soldier fish swarming the wreck, the large trumpet fish that came in for a closer look is perhaps too long and bony to be on the menu. That being said, morays are more than capable of crunching through tough skeletons and shells, and the small lobster living underneath the wreck was not taking any chances. Despite the presence of enormous ocean predators dominating the scene, when watching these baited camera drops, it's also important to zoom in from time to time, for some of the most interesting critters are a little bit more difficult to spot. The sand was alive with crustaceans, mollusks, and other echinoderms. Large scavenging rock crabs were quick to find the bait, although whilst dodging the enormous eels, they also had to fend off tactical approaches by numerous cardinal fish that favoured moving prey over the fish and squid in the cage. Large numbers of sand-dwelling snails also emerged, navigating using their siphons that detect the chemical scents of carrion on the ocean floor. Now, one of the other really interesting behaviours of reef fish is their use of sound to communicate. Grunts and clicks are their preferred vocalizations, and they can be incredibly loud. Fish vocalize for a whole host of different reasons, including to warn their schoolmates of an incoming threat, which might be a moray eel the size of a tree trunk, or something much scarier, me. Oh, and in case you were wondering, the eels definitely do not share the same concern.
Oh, look at that guy.
However, the main reason for building this infrared camera is to uncover the elusive sharks and rays that come out at night, and I still wasn't sure whether they were keeping their distance. There was one more spot left to try.
Okay guys, so the good news is...
Wait for it.
Okay, the good news is we proved that in the shallow water, smaller fish and the eels are happy coming close to the infrared camera, which is really good, but the main point of building this camera was so that we can get the stuff that lives in the really deep water out there to come closer, like the sharks and rays. It typically stay away from the really bright light. So plan for tonight is I'm gonna swim all the way out there as far as I can, go as deep as I can, drop the camera down with loads of fresh smelly bait, and we're gonna see what we can draw in. I'm really hopeful that we'll get some sharks and rays and prove that it works, but yeah, we've had some big stuff here before. Who knows, let's do it.
And on the way back up, I made sure to spread the word.
Hello, Mr. Stingray. The camera's down there, buddy. Just down there, maybe 20, 30 meters further down. Hopefully you make it. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that way. Perfect, good job.
Over the course of two nights, I dropped two cameras down at about 40 meters on the sand. On both drops, snappers were a common sighting, and it seemed clear that any concerns about the light were limited as they came close and mopped up a few free offerings. Larger reef fish, like this big blubberlip snapper and a school of large unicorn fish, kept their distance. In addition to the snappers, a small emperor also came to investigate. One of the major limitations of infrared light is you lose colour detail, which can make identifying fish a little bit more difficult, but I'm fairly sure this species is the small-tooth emperor, armed with a long, sharp snout that it uses for digging around in tight spaces. At these depths, you can also find a wide variety of planktonic critters, including some that seem to produce light. Others, like this larvation, drift around with a large mucus net extended, hoping to catch prey to feed on. However, I didn't swim down into the dark depths on my own to record plankton. This is an enormous marbled stingray, so named because of the blotched marble-like pattern on its body. Now, these rays are huge, with the biggest individuals reaching 3 meters in diameter and weighing over 300 kilograms. Like all stingrays, they're also armed with a foot-long stinger on their tail, a weapon used to deter predators. Now, this ray swam around for a while before eventually settling down on top of the cage and looking straight into the camera lens. I've never recorded a marbled stingray in this area before, nor have I heard of other divers encountering them. Does this mean the night vision camera is perhaps the key to finding out what really lives at the bottom of our oceans? I guess we'll have to drop some more cameras to find out. Subscribe if you want to see what we find all the way down at 200 meters. And if you're in the mood for more camera drops, you'll probably like this video.